Let the others join. Shall we discuss what are the things we have discussed in the last class? So, what are the things we have seen yesterday? Divakar, can anyone think that we have seen today's class? Okay. Then
also got to know why we learn about our history, past.
Others, except Yali, no one listened to the class. Sources. We have seen what are all the meanings of ancient history, why we call it as ancient or medieval, modern, everything. And after that, we have seen a list of things, what are all the things we are going to see in the ancient history. So, to study all those ancient, medieval, and modern history, we need sources. Somewhere, we have to find the things which are supporting the material documents or any literary documents which are supporting the past lives. So, that materials is known as sources. So let's see about the sources of ancient Indian history. I hope everyone is having a note or paper and pen.
Yes, ma'am.
We have seen this, right?
Yes.
You are able to see the screen. So we have seen sources are very important, for the reconstruction of past. Through the sources only we are able to know about the past. And we classified the sources into three main categories, which are all literary, archaeological, and foreign accounts. So let's see about the archaeological sources, which are all the things that comes under archaeological sources. First of all, what is archaeological sources? The sources which are discovered or came to our knowledge through the archaeological excavations. Excavations means, you all know, I guess, we don't need to go into deep definitions about archaeology and everything. Just know what is what. Okay. So, what are all the sources which comes under archaeological sources? Inscriptions, coins, seals, potteries, monuments, caves, sculptures, etc. I have already told you the study of coins is known as numismatics and the study of inscription is known as epigraphy. Right? Okay. What is inscriptions? Inscriptions, as I told you earlier, the inscriptions are very important part of the archaeological sources. And we can, say that inscriptions are more authentic than literary sources and foreign accounts. Because whoever is writing a literature must be the person who is working with the dynasty or who is responsible for the rulers. Right? Or they'll be working under a ruler and they want to praise their country, so they'll be writing it instead. But inscriptions are not like that, so we can rely and say that these inscriptions are more authentic compared to other sources, and they are less biased comparatively to the other sources. Yesterday someone told that Ashoka's inscriptions are very important and he contributed more for the inscriptions, right? So, it means he has given lots of inscriptions in pillars and rock edicts. So, there are 14 major and minor rock edicts, and also there are numerous pillar inscriptions also from Ashoka. And most of his inscriptions are in the Brahmi script. So, what does the script means? Anybody know?
Is it like a language that was used in the previous year, previous ma'am?
No, I'm not asking about what is Brahmi. I'm asking about script.
Ma'am, anything in different formats.
It as Brahmi language or Pali language or Tamil language. But we are saying it as, script. Why are we using this word script? What is the difference between language and script?
Script is the anything in written formats, ma'am.
Written format, okay.
It's not a completely developed language.
Pattern of writing. It can be, script can be in both from right to left or left to right. For example, Arab is used to write in a left to right way. It's a way of writing, not the script. Okay, I'll tell you. The language, how are you all texting with your friends? I hope not everybody's, mother tongue is English, right? We all come from different mother tongues. We all will be texting with our friends, right? In a WhatsApp, social media, other social medias like Facebook, Instagram, everything, you are texting with your friends. In which language you are texting?
Tanglish, ma'am.
Tanglish. we are writing in English, right?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am.
Yes. For example, if, what to say? Say some sentence in Tamil. Okay. If you are asking your friend, how are you? How will you say, or where are you? Or whatever. Thank food. How will you type in English? Eppadi iruka? Right? Yes. I'm using Tamil because I am comfortable in Tamil. That's why I'm using Tamil. Okay. Eppadi iruka means how are you in English. But we are typing it as in English we are typing. Right? Yes or no? So here the script is English but the language is Tamil. Same wise, most of the Ashokan's inscriptions are Brahmi script but we don't know whether it is a Brahmi language or Pali language or Prakrit language. Most of his inscriptions are in Prakrit and Pali language, which is one of the vernacular languages. You will know about, I know this terms and names are very different and you know, be hearing it for the first time. So it will be a little confusing. Once you start revising the same lessons again and again, you will get to know what is what and what is, you know, names of the language, what is the names of the emperor, what is the names of the empire. Everything will be different, able to differentiate for like after three to four revisions, you will be able to differentiate it. Don't worry about like, ma'am saying some words and I don't understand anything. Okay. It will be, when you are hearing for the first time, it will be like that only. Don't get, you know, very alienated with the words. It's just some of the names of the books and names. And other inscriptions are Prayag Prashasti inscriptions of Chandragupta Maurya, Atikumba inscriptions of Karavela, Aihole inscriptions of Pulikesi. These are all very important inscriptions. And we will be definitely studying all these inscriptions. Whenever we are studying about Ashoka, we will be studying all the important inscriptions, rock, pillar, everything. And the same as while studying about Chandragupta, we'll be studying about Prayag Prashasti inscriptions. Atikumba inscriptions of Karavela is very important because, okay, just know about the inscriptions and names. Okay, we discuss it in detail in the upcoming classes. The entire history of Satavahanas is based on the archaeological sources. These Satavahanas are one of the Indo-Greeks who came to India after the Mauryans. Next, coins. The study of coins is known as
numismatics.
And the coins are also very immense importance because through coins we came to know about the leaders or the rulers who were ruling of the dynasty or empire will be known through the coins. More importantly, we came to know about the economic conditions of the ancient period because later, like in the medieval period and all, the paper was invented and the, you know, printing press was invented. So after that, we came to know about the literature and people know to write, read and everything. But in the ancient time, even in the prehistory, like proto-history times, we found coins. With the coins only, we are able to understand who was ruling what. And it also describes the technological development of the ancient period. And the dates mentioned in the coins helps us to know about the chronology of the particular king. And it also have the coins, it also has idols of religious worships in the coins. So we came to know about the religious idealism also. And the first coin of India was known as punchmarked coins. Can you guess why we call it as a punchmarked coins? Sorry?
Because it was punched with something like stone on the metal.
Yes, it was punched. For example, if they are we will be seeing in the Indus Valley Civilization, their weight system was very, unique. It was like square shaped. But the punchmarked coins is called as punchmarked because in the stamp, they'll be punching something, markings. For example, a ruler's face or a god's face or any animal or any particular symbol, which was all punched in the coin. So it was known as punchmarked coins. And these coins are, it is believed that these coins are possibly introduced by the trading guilds and not by the rulers. You know why? Because the rulers are not known about all their technologies. But when they start trading, the trading and commerce was started even in the early, like, proto-history, like Indus Valley Civilization, even before Indus Valley Civilization, the barter system was used to exchange the commodities. So, with the help of that, they would have invented coins also. For example, the first gold coin, it was introduced by Indo-Greeks who came to India. And the purest gold coin was issued by Kushans. It was by Kanishka. Okay. Just remember the names. And these are all very factual. There'll be questions like who introduced the first gold coin or the maximum number of gold coins and impure gold coins was introduced by who. They'll be asking questions directly like this. Can anyone guess who will be having the maximum, gold coins and most impure gold coins were issued by who? I don't want to give the name particularly, but any guesses which period it would be, like Marathas or Mauryas or Guptas, like that?
Vijayanagara Empire?
No. Vijayanagars, they didn't issue maximum gold coins. You would have heard about the golden age of India, which is considered as the golden age of India. Golden age of India and Indian history, it was considered as... Guptas were considered as golden age because they issued maximum number of gold coins. And they were able to issue maximum number of gold coins because it was the most impure and they mixed the gold with copper and other metals along with it. Okay, so the first gold coin was introduced by Indo-Greeks and the purest form of gold coins issued by Kushans. The maximum and impure was by Guptas. The next one is monuments and memorials. So, why do we need to study about monuments? Monuments means, you know, right? Big statues, buildings and everything is considered as monuments. Okay, you can just see and tell. It's like, it's not just to predict their, technical skills, but it also gives us information about the architectural styles and their living standard, economic condition and, we all used to talk about our famous, if someone is from a particular place, we will be asking what is famous in your place. For example, if we talk about Madurai, we'll definitely talk about Meenakshi Amman temple. And if it is Tanjavur, we'll be talking about Brahadishwara temple. So why we're talking about the memorials means it shows the wealth, economic conditions and the people who lived in that period will be, their way of lifestyle, everything will be depicted. And in some temples, it will be like inscriptions will be there saying all the, good things and all the things that are happened during that period, everything will be depicted in it. So that's why it is very important to know about the monuments also. This monuments is not just, architectural form of, it's not just for the beautification or showing off. It's kind of showing off their skills, standard of living. I am more, wealthier than you, like that, they'll be started. There are only three styles. Some of the words are missing here. No issues. There are three styles of architecture in India. One is Nagar or Nagara style of architecture, which is used in North India. And Dravidian style of architecture is used in South India. And in the Deccan part, it is known as Besar style or Besara style of architecture. When we will be studying about art and architecture of Mughals and Medieval India, we will be seeing all the details about, what is Nagara style, what is Dravidian style and everything. One thing is, in Nagara and Besara style, the tomb of the, particular temple or any building or fort, it will be like oval shape, like which is in Taj Mahal, like for example, like this. Okay. And in Dravidian style, it will be like temples. You know that, right? Steps will be there. Like this, it will be. And this is Dravidian and that is Nagara. In Vizara's trail, the both will be included. For example, the half part of the, like this, it will be. Okay. So these are all called Vizara's trail. Potteries. Potteries, you know, as I said, the only and, you know, most important sources for the prehistory, like Lithic age and during the Paleolithic, Mesolithic period, Paleolithic and Mesolithic, they were not into actually pottery and all. But later periods, like before invention of civilization and before the people started in a sedentary life and, you know, in a ruling clan and everything, the potteries were used by all the peoples for their everyday routine. So, this it is very you know, available, and it is, you know, most how to say, huge part of sources which are available in the Vedic and pre-Vedic period is potteries. During the Rig Vedic period, they used, you know, it's like black red ware, gray ware, and all this. Later Vedic period, they started using even in the paintings were used in potteries with the geometric patterns and sculptures. You know, sculptures means, yes or no, statues, only statues. Okay, just no, sculptures are statues and other idols that are created using the stones or any kind of metals, clay, everything. So there are three different styles of sculptures. One is Gandhara and another one is Mathura and Amaravati style of sculptures. And when we go back to paintings, I already told you yesterday, like Ajanta and Ellora caves are very, you know, unique style of paintings. They used, you know, natural colors and they used the natural scenes and humanitarian scenes to paint in the caves. These are archaeological sources. So what are all the things we have seen in archaeological sources? Inscriptions, coins, monuments and memorials, potteries, sculptures, paintings. The next one is literary sources. The literary sources is divided into two divisions, which is religious source and non-religious sources. And also, you know, in religious sources, we'll be seeing about all the Vedic texts, epics, Puranas, Smritis, Shruti texts, Buddhist texts, Jainism. I haven't included the Buddhist, Jain texts and Sinhalese texts because we will be studying the same in the Buddhism and Jainism. When you'll be studying Buddhism and Jainism, it will be easy to understand all the texts along with the story of the Buddhism and Jainism instead of studying all together in the same time. Okay, because all this will be very confusing and exhausting for you also. So, religious texts are like, you know, basically literary sources formed with the Brahmin texts such as Vedas, Vedangas, Upavedas, everything comes under the religious texts. Puranas, epics, Shruti, Smriti, Sutras, everything is religious texts. So, what are all the Vedas you know? How many Vedas?
Four.
Four. Okay. Rig, Yajur, Sama, Atharva. These are the four Vedas we know. But read it in this order, Rig, Sama, Yajur, Atharva, because the chronological order is very, very important. The questions might be asking, which is the chronological order? So, Rig, Sama, Yajur, Atharva. These are the four important Vedas. And Rig Veda is known as early Vedic. Only, you know, hymns are depicted in the Rig Veda. And it is the oldest one in the Vedic text. All the three are later Vedic or Vedic texts. These texts helps us with the information about origin of Aryans. Who is this Aryans? Again, Aryans, their political structure, society, economic activities, and everything will be discussed in the... it helps us to know a lot about the people's structure, economic activities, the religious and cultural activities through the texts. So, I asked who's Aryans, right? Who's this Aryans?
Ma'am, Central Asian people.
Central Asian peoples. Very good. So, they come from the Middle Asian countries. we see about the Aryans also. No worries. So, the sutras. Sutras means after the Vedic texts, they arrived an era of sutras. These sutras are informations about the Vedic period. That means we are not able to understand and, you know, clearly able to read and understand the Vedas, which was written in their own, you know, language. So, in order to understand these Vedas, there are some of the Vedangas were formed. These Vedangas are divided into six parts, which is our Shiksha, Vyakaran, phonetics. You know, in English, there are phonetics, right? English classes are started, right?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, what is phonetics?
Ma'am, sounds of letters.
Sounds of the letters, right? So, there are 26 letters in English and we have 44 phonetics for that. Means, we have different sounds for the same letter, right? The Shiksha is given, Shiksha here means the phonetics of the Vedic text. And Vyakaran means grammar, okay? Chand means metrics. You all would have studied maths, right? Matrix and all. The same thing will be applied here also. Kalpa means the rituals which are practicing in the study about the rituals is known as Jyotisha means astrology. And again, Nirukta means, okay, this, give me a minute. Shiksha means, is phonetics. Vyakaran means grammar. Chanda means metrics. Kalpa means rituals. And Nirukta means, what they say, this means etymology. This is the six Vedangas. I haven't included the meanings of this. When I'm sending the PDF, I'll include and send it to you. Okay. Upavedas. Upavedas means the same like Vedangas, there was a Upaveda, which just gives the, you know, what is studied under the Veda, and that was given in a name. Okay. There are four Vedas. So, to support the Vedas, there are four Upavedas. So, Ayurveda means it is related to medical science. You all would have heard this Ayurveda. So, it's not very confusing for you to remember, right? So, Ayurveda means it is related to medical science and it is Upaveda of Rig Veda. And Gandharva Veda means it is related to music and it is Upaveda of Samaveda. And Dhanurveda is war skills. If you would have heard about Mahabharata and everything, the word Dhanur is used in the most widely used, because Dhanur means what? Okay, it's about war skills and arms and ammunitions. Okay, it is related to Yajurveda. And Shilpa Veda means it is related to arts, sculpture, architecture and everything. And it is a Upaveda of Adava Veda. Okay, so what are all the four Upavedas? Ayur, Gandharva, Dhanur and Shilpa Veda. Okay, and Smriti text. So, after the sutras, Smriti texts were formed. The Smriti texts are, it's like a compilation of a work from a person to give about the particular dynasty or particular period or particular, you know, ruler. It gives a information about that person. So, the oldest Smriti text is Manu Smriti, written by Manu, and Yajnavalkya Smriti, and it was another Smriti text which is compiled between 100 to 300 AD. Manu Smriti was formed between 200 BC to 200 AD, which is like 400 years. And in this text only, Manu Smriti only, there are the sections of people. You would have heard about, you know, four divisions of people. Yes or no? Any idea what is Manu Smriti? No?
Not sure, ma'am.
Not sure. Okay, if I say, you will be remembering. Like, you all would have heard that humans are classified and came from Brahma, and the Brahmins came from Brahma's head, and the Kshatriyas came from Brahma's chest, and Vaishyas came from Brahma's leg, thighs, and the Sudras came from the feet of the Brahma. This story you all would have heard, right? So that story was given and all the related, informations about that people have classified from the occupations, whatever the occupation they are doing, they'll be classified from them. So that Manusmriti, that text is known as Manusmriti. Okay. And these two, Manusmriti and Yajnavalkya, throws light on the post-Mauryan period. And Narada Smriti and Parashara Smriti is giving the conditions of Guptas. Besides the Brihaspati Smriti and Katyayana Smriti also gives information about the Gupta time only. The next is Puranas. What is Puranas?
Epics.
What is epics? Okay, what is epics again? Epics means stories, right?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes. Then Puranas, these are also, stories. Yes?
Yes.
Yes. What is the difference between epics and Puranas? We know that two great epics there, Ramayana and Mahabharata, right? Okay, I know you know.
Yes, ma'am.
But Puranas are the difference. I'll tell you in a simple words. For example, epics are long stories which have some, informations and sources. But Puranas are not like that. Even if we have the evidences, it's a myths, all the stories which have mythical informations, which are known as Puranas. Okay? So, there are 18 Puranas. Among those, Markandeya, Vayu, Brahma, Vishnu, Bhagavat and Matsya. These six are ancient Puranas and others were created later. That means these six Puranas belongs to the early Vedic period and other 12 are from later Vedic period. These are the 18 Puranas. You can have a glance. Agni, Brahma, Vaivarta, Kurma and Markandeya, Narada, Shiva, Vamana, Bhagavata, Brahmanda, Garuda, Linga, Matsya, Padma, Skanta, Varaha, Vishnu and Vayu. So all this has some of the stories. We don't know whether it is true or not. In that sense, we call it as Puranas. Okay? Epics. As we see, epics are Mahabharata and Ramayana. You all know that Ramayana is written by Valmiki and there is another version of Ramayana which is written in by Kamba, that is known as Kamba Ramayana. And historically, we don't have great proof for the incidents of Ramayana except what? How do we know that Ramayana has happened? You all would have thought of going to Rameshwaram for that, seeing that bridge made with stones which is floating in the ocean, right? I hope I would you all would have heard about it. If not, no problem. Only that is the source that we can able to say that Ramayana has happened actually. Other than that, we don't have any historical proof of Ramayana, but it gives details about the Indian society, whatever it happened in that during that period. And Mahabharata was the second epic, which was compiled by, think about it, Vyasir. Yes, he compiled the Mahabharata and it was completed in the Gupta period only. And it was initially named as Jai Samhita. So after that, it came to known it as a Bharata, because it consisted of history of the Indian dynasties. And later it became the name as Mahabharata because it shows the history of all the rulers who ruled and fought between each other in the Bharat land. That's why it gets the name of Mahabharata. Okay. And these are the religious texts. As I said, I haven't included Buddhist texts and Buddhist, Jains and Sinhalese texts. we'll be studying all those literatures in Buddhism and Jainism chapters. And non-religious texts, we've seen. Yesterday, I told you some of the non-religious texts, which is not here. Can anyone remember any of the names which I gave yesterday? So basically, if you remember, just tell. If not, no problem. Okay, I'll continue with the class. So non-religious texts are mainly the religious text gives information about the religious ideology and the philosophy and the worship, cultural activities and everything. And it gave only a few or little information about the political activity and non-religious administration and everything. So this non-religious text gives information about the political administration and everything. So Ashtadhyayi was written by Panini. It is one of the oldest grammar and literature of India. It gives information about the political, social and religious conditions about pre-Mauryan dynasty. We'll see why we call it as pre-Mauryan, why we call it as post-Mauryan, why we are using Mauryan as a timeline like this. It gives information about Mauryan Empire. And Harshashastra, yesterday I told you, right? Who is this Kautilya? Any idea?
Ma'am, Minister of Chandragupta Maurya.
Minister of Chandragupta Maurya. Very good. He is the person who is responsible for Chandragupta Maurya to take over the throne by a throne from Nanda dynasty's Dhanananda. Okay. So, he is the actual reason why we are studying Indian history as like current Indian history is like, you know, before like pre-proto history, after that will comes historical period. The historical period starts with Kautilya because we say, as I said previously, we are saying that, for example, we are saying it as pre-Mauryan, right? So why we are saying it as pre-Mauryan, and we considered Mauryans as the major breakthrough, or we considered Mauryans as the starting of the ancient history. Before that, there were few rulers and we call them as a pre-Mauryans. After the Mauryans, we call them as a post-Mauryans. These Mauryans are very important in Indian ancient history and got into power because of this Kautilya. Get it? This is known as Vishnugupta and Chanakya also, and is also, you know, called as a Machiavelli of India. And this Arshashastra was divided into 15 parts. It gives overall administration and political information about the Mauryan period. And the next one is Mahabhashya of Patanjali. And another one is Malavika Agnimitra by Kalidasa. So nowadays people, you know, the celebrities and even couples use their, you know, name into one name, right? Suddenly, I don't get any examples, but if you could say anything, I'll go with that. But you know what I'm saying, right? People like people use the all the, you know, couples into like one name, two names, means they'll merge it into one name and they'll using. This is the first, you know, name like that, because this Malavika Agnimitram is a love story between Malavika. She's a person, and Agnimitra. Agnimitra was a ruler. So it's a love story between Malavika and Agnimitra. So this is the, you know, origin of this, you know, merging of names, couple names. So next time when you see any persons are merging their name, you should remember this Malavika Agnimitram by Kalidasa is the origin of this kind of names. And it both Mahavashya of Patanjali and Malavika Agnimitra gives information about Asunga dynasty. And Kama Sutra of Vatsyana gives information about sexual life, social life, physical relations, family life, etc. It just does not give only this information. It is the source that we came to know that these youth of the period get sex education from the book. Okay. And Amruchakatikam by Shudraka and Deshkumara Charitam. It is given as Deshkumar by Dandan. which is also gives information about the social life of the early life. I mean, ancient Indian history. And these are the some of the non-religious texts. Everything is important. We will be studying about all this during the pre-Mauryan. Whichever ruler supported the poet, we will be seeing about that. Just remember the name and poet name. The next one is foreign accounts. Foreign accounts are, you know, as I already told you, foreign accounts are very important because they give the actual truth about the Indian cities or Indian economic, social and political lifestyle of the people in the ancient period. The most important people who gave foreign accounts to Indian history or contributed to Indian history is Greek, Romans, Chinese and Arab travels. Greek and Roman writers are Herodotus and Thucydides. Does anyone know who is this Herodotus? Any history background students are here. Okay, Herodotus is known as the father of history, and his writings and Thucydides' writings are possibly, too important, possibly known as the great contributors of history. And another important account is Indica. Yesterday, I told you about this book, Indica by who? Who's the author of the Indica?
Megasthenes.
Megasthenes, very good. So, Megasthenes Indica is another important source. He gave, in this Indica, he has, given seven sections of Indian society, and he classified the people's, social life. Indica is, completely giving the social structure of the ancient period. And the same, another one is Pericles of Eretrian Sea, is another Greek work written by unknown. We don't know who written the Pericles of Eretrian Sea, but it gives the most important information about ports of the Indian. Okay. It gives the, sea trading and everything. Sea transportation informations are contained, consist in the Pericles of Eretrian Sea. And Ptolemy, you would have heard about him. He's a great geographer. He written about geographic descriptions of India in the 2nd century AD. And Pliny the Elder is a Roman historian who wrote Naturalis Historica in 1st century AD, which also gives plenty of information about animals, crops and minerals in India. So, these are the Roman and Greek travelers. Chinese travelers, we said yesterday that Fa Hian, Yuan Shuang and He Shuang. He Sing. So these three are the most important, travelers who contributed most of the ancient history. As Fa Hian visited in the 5th century AD and he stayed for up to 14 years, and Yuan Shuang during the time of Asha and he stayed for 16 years, and He Sing visited India at the end of 17th century AD and he for a long time in Vikramshala and Nalanda University. These are the oldest universities in India, and Nalanda is one of the oldest universities in the world. We will study about all these universities and all. Don't, get too much of information in the same time. Just remember, they all came and they stayed for a long time. So, besides this, they also contributed a lot to the Buddhist and Jainist texts also, and Arab travelers. These Arab travelers begin to write about India in 8th century AD, and the Sulaiman al-Tajir is he used to carry the, his baggage, and there is a picture of him. I didn't include it, but I'll show you in the upcoming classes. So, he gave more information about Palas, Pratiharas and Gurjars. We'll be studying about these three, because after the end of Indian rulers, these Palas, Pratiharas and Gurjars will come, and they three will be constantly fighting, and they came to known as tripartite struggle. That is because of these three groups only. Mal Mashudi, he stayed in India for only 2 years and wrote about the Rashtrakuta rulers. Abu Rahman Rahan Al-Biruni. this Alberoni is another important, you know, traveler or author who contributed a lot to Indian history. We'll see about Alberoni particularly in the medieval history. He wrote Kitab al-Hind. It gives information about the mathematics, geography, philosophy and other religious practices. So I think that's all. These are the sources of ancient Indian history. If anybody has doubts or any clarification, you can ask now. Others can leave the class. We'll wind up.
Thank you.